Judges chapter 13, beginning at verse 24. And the woman bore a son and called his name Samson. And the child grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move him at times. Listen to that phrase. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move him at times. In the camp of Dan, between Zorah and Eshtaol. Jump down now to chapter 14 of the same book, Judges chapter 14, verse 5. I saw Isaac. Clap your hands, everybody, for Isaac. Let me pray about you, Isaac. So glad that you're here. Judges 14, beginning at verse 5. Anne-Marie. Corey, we're praying for you. We prayed for you last week in particular, okay? And I know Kian would have loved to be here today, but she had to do a test at the hospital. And we continue to remember Kian in our prayers. Judges 14, verse 5. Then went Samson down and his father and his mother to Timnath and came to the vineyards of Timnath. And behold, a young lion roared against him. Look at verse 6 now. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him. And he rent him as he would have rented a kid. And he had nothing in his hand. But he told not his father or his mother what he had done. Jump down to verse 19 of the same text. Judges chapter 14. Verse 19, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he went down to Ashkelon, and slew 30 men of them, and took their spoil, and gave change of garments unto them, which expounded the riddle. Jump down now to the next chapter, Judges 15, verse 14. And when he came unto Lehi, the Philistines shouted against him. Look at this phrase again. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him. And the cords that were upon his arms became as flask that was burnt with fire. And his bands loosed from off his hands. Verse 15. And he found a new jawbone of an ass and put forth his hand and took it and slew 1,000 men therewith. Jump down now to chapter 16, verse 16. Beginning of verse 16. Judges 16, verse 16. And it came to pass when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him, so that his soul was vexed unto death, that he told her all his heart, and said unto her, there hath not come a razor upon my head, for I have been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I shall become weak and be like any other man. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines, saying, come up this once, for he hath showed me all his heart. Then the lords of the Philistines came up unto her and brought money in their hand. And she made him sleep upon her knees, and she called for a man. And she caused him to shave off the 7 locks of his head. And she began to afflict him, and his strength went from him. And she said, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And he awoke out of his sleep and said, I will go out as at other times before and shake myself. And he did not know that the Lord was departed from him. Just before you're seated, as we continue the sermon series, The Church Triumphant, with the real need of the Holy Spirit to help us today, I would like for us to traverse a sub-theme entitled Unwrapping the Mystery and the Majesty of the Holy Spirit. Unwrapping the Mystery and the Majesty of the Holy Spirit. Before you're seated, let's pray together. Will you pray this prayer with me? Lord, help me to grow, and help me to help others also. Let's try that one more time. Lord, help me to grow, and help me to help others also. In Jesus' name. Bless you. You may be seated. Please observe in our text how many times the Bible records that the Spirit of the Lord moved mightily upon Samson. From he was a child to when he killed a young lion, to when he killed 30 men in Ashkelon, to when he killed 1,000 Philistines with the jawbone of an ass. Then observe how the same Philistines were able to subdue Samson, who did not even recognize that the Spirit of the Lord had left him when he came into Delilah's constant cunning luring. From these Old Testament narratives, we observe the timeless principle that the Spirit of God moves upon a chosen vessel at a specific time, in specific ways, and for specific reasons. Let me say that again. From this narrative, all the scriptures we read in Judges from chapter 13 to chapter 16, we observe the timeless principle that the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God, moves upon a chosen vessel at specific times, in specific ways, and for specific reasons. Now, no one can live or last as a believer of Christ, that is, without the Spirit of Christ. Romans 8 verse 9 says, "But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you."
Yes.
Now, if any man, or that word man is being translated person, if any person have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. No one can truly do supernatural things without the Spirit of Christ.
Yes.
Zechariah 4 verse 6, the last clause says, "Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts." Now, listen to these points. Talents combined with hard work and resilience can accomplish superhuman things. But only the Spirit of God working in us can accomplish supernatural things.
Mm. Yes.
The best version of ourselves is not what we can accomplish in our own abilities. Rather, the best version of ourselves is what we can accomplish beyond ourselves when the Holy Spirit is completely activated in us. So Karina, our super soccer star, she has a slogan that she uses sometimes, She says, "Be God great." She could have said, "Be human great." And human greatness can be very great. But when you're God great, you are taking all of your abilities, you're taking as far as you can go if you truly give it your
But to tap into that level of greatness requires the Spirit of Almighty God moving in and through us in a very extraordinary way. Amen. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Now, receiving the Holy Spirit is a different experience from becoming a new believer in Christ. Let me say that again.
Amen.
Receiving the Holy Spirit is a different experience from becoming a believer in Christ.
Yes.
Let me pause. To drink my Milo. One of the challenges with a lot of large crowds and large churches today is that the churches have learned how to attract people by leading them to that stage of becoming a believer in Christ. But there are different dimensions in Christ that we need to continue to traverse. No couple wanna live just in the marriage ceremony day or even on the honeymoon time. If you truly love each other, you want a new life. You want to keep growing. You want to continue on the journey, Brother David. And when you believe in Christ, that is a good step. But this is another step from being a believer to be infused with the Spirit of Almighty God. Acts chapter 19, verse 2. There's a question that is asked in that verse. Have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? In other words, you can believe and not have the Holy Ghost. Look at what the disciples of John's response was. They said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. Sometimes we pastors are derelict in our duties because we have not preached or we have not emphasized that there is a Holy Ghost. So people believe the message, but they think that that's all there is to it. There is more.
Amen.
There is more.
Yes.
I said there is more.
Amen.
And for our church to truly come alive, much more than the stage presence, much more than the musical abilities, much more than the preacher who dressed sharp like Denzel Washington.
See visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids.
everybody, 80% of the church, is 50 years old and older. Because they came to church at a time when a lot of people used to go to church. But a lot of young people are tuning out church. Part of the reason is because we have not unwrapped the Holy Spirit. Because when the Holy Spirit is unwrapped in our churches, it is for the old people. But it is also for the young people.
Amen.
It is for those who are wealthy and have means. And it is for the maidens and the person who is just getting off EI. Ephesians 1 verse 13. In whom you also trusted, after that you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, look at that, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So you believe that you are sealed with that Holy Spirit. Oh God, I gotta stop for a little. I don't mean to walk around today. But when you're sealed, you know, there's some cans. Have you ever bought something and you're trying to open the cover, the cork, and it's like, you have to exercise a lot of muscle.
Yes.
Because it's so sealed. Yes. And sometimes it's sealed for good reasons. Because if that stripper is ever broken at the wrong time, what is inside of it can be spoiled. So some things need to be sealed so that it can be kept or preserved. And when we're filled with the Holy Spirit, the Lord seals us.
Amen.
In other words, He preserves us, Alex.
Yes.
That way we are kept.
Yes. Yes.
Oh.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. Yes.
And when we are kept, guess what? It doesn't matter what storm winds will blow.
Yes.
We are kept. Across churches, across cultures, across countries, across continents is divided because we have not correctly unwrapped the mystery and the majesty of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Today, with the help of the Lord, I would like us to unwrap this mystery so that we can understand the majesty of the Holy Spirit. There are two extreme teachings about the Holy Spirit as it relates to speaking in tongues. Where are my extreme people? Extreme people, go to your corners if they wake up. Extreme people. You gotta walk faster. So, there are two extreme teachings about the Holy Spirit as it relates to speaking in tongues. One extreme is the teaching that speaking in tongues is the first or initial sign that a believer has received the Holy Ghost. And although there is no recorded reference to the phrase initial evidence in the entire Bible, the reference initial evidence has become a church jargon in some Christian circles, in part because of Acts chapter 10, verse 45. And they of the circumcision, referring to the Jews, which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For, this is why they say that tongues is the initial evidence, because verse 46 says, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Now, the other extreme is the teaching that speaking in tongues is not for believers today, or at least not for every believer. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 18 is part of why they come to this conclusion. I thank my God, I speak with tongues more than ye all. Verse 19, yet in the church I had rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. All right? Now, so here are the extremes. The extreme is there's a church group over here that says, can you hold it up so everybody can read it? Hold it to your chest, okay? There's a church group that says speaking in tongues is a must. And they say, unless you speak in tongues, you do not have the Holy Spirit. That's one group. Then the next group is over here. And this group says, speaking in tongues is not required. Now, here's what has happened in the church world. The group that is over here and the group that's over here has started a war, just like Syria versus America. So those who believe that tongues is a must, if there are other people who have experienced other manifestations of the Holy Spirit, these guys over here discredit those people, saying to them, you are not really saved, you don't really have the Holy Spirit because you haven't spoken in tongues. Then, the group over there that says speaking in tongues is not required. Then you've got the people over here who are only speaking in tongues, and they say, those are the crazy people. And because of that, people determine which church to go to depending on certain things. One of them is how you're baptized. Another is how you dress. If you notice for the last few weeks, I've not worn a tie. I'm doing that for a reason. The whole month of April, I'm not wearing a tie. Why? I want to try and get us out of some of the tradition that says you have to look a certain way when you come to church. Now, am I telling you to stop wearing your tie? No. And your No. Next month, Lord willing, I may put on a tie. I may put on a suit, or I may not. What I'm trying to do is to get us out of these conventional places where we say everybody needs to look alike. Like some clone. So the baptism is one of the things that divide us. How we dress and church standards is another that divides us. The third main areas of church division is the Holy Spirit. We are divided based on how we understand the workings of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to try my best with the Holy Spirit today to help you to understand how beautiful the Holy Spirit is and to let you understand that this group and this group have no business competing with each other. When we do that, we divide the body of Christ. When we do that, we turn the fight inward instead of on the devil. Amen. Let's clap our hands for these two groups. You may be seated. Thank you so much. Now, instead of equivalating, speaking in tongues with the Holy Spirit, in other words, instead of putting speaking in tongues on the same level as the Holy Spirit, we should consider all the evidences of the Holy Spirit. There are many evidences of the Holy Spirit, and I want to go through them quickly. If you have your card, as soon as I call your evidence, and you need to come and be in your spot. The first evidence that I would like to suggest to us today is anyone who truly confess Christ. If you truly confess Christ, I'm submitting that that is a sign that you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me give you a scripture for it. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3 says, "Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed." Look at this now. "And that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost." So you truly can't confess Christ. You truly can't admit that Jesus is Lord unless the Lord has already overshadowed you. Next evidence, abundant satisfying joy. Come quickly. All of you who, when I call you, you gotta move with a little spring in your steps, okay? Maybe you guys should start to have Milo in the morning. Because you guys are dragging. Now, give yourself some space between each other. Abundant satisfying joy. John 4, verse 13. Jesus answered and said unto her, "Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again." Verse 14. "But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." In other words, when you truly receive the Holy Spirit, there's something different about you. You know how I know that a lot of people don't have the Holy Spirit? Always look so sad. Look sad at church. Look sad even when you're watching a soccer game, they look sad. Even when they should be happy, they look sad. How can you always be sad? Even if you have the worst spouse chained to you. If you have the Holy Spirit, my God, man, you must get a day off where you're not on this side. The Bible says the joy of the Lord. Come on, somebody preach to me. The joy of the Lord. Let me see. When you say that this guy is, does he have the joy of the Lord? I think so. Alex, how am I doing so far? Am I doing good out so far? All right, good, good. All right, the third one is supernatural fire. Where's the fireman? Supernatural fire. This is one of the things that churches don't have today. Especially when we come to North America and everybody trying to be, composed and put together. When you come to church, you shouldn't make too much noise. You shouldn't get too excited. Let me tell you what the Bible says. Luke chapter 3, verse 16. John answered, saying unto them, all, I may baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, the latches of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with
fire.
I remember 9/11 when it happened. I was in Jamaica. Never forget it. When those planes hit those twin towers, it was one of the most horrific visual anybody could ever see. People were jumping off of buildings, thinking that's better than staying in a burning building. And I watched executives on Wall Street with their attaché case, with their dignified suits, running for their lives because there's fire. And all those people who want to pressure me and tell me, Pastor, tone down the church a little. Pastor, my personality, I don't like to get too ruffled.
But
you want some form of fire to come and light your people. And there are different kinds of fire in the force. In fact, the Bible talks about even strange fires. You can have some fire, some trials that can overtake you, that can cause you to be walking around almost crazy. But oh, I love the fire of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You know why I love that fire? It burns, but it does not consume. Moses! I'm looking at this burning bush. It is spectacular. It is ablaze. But it is not consuming. I love the fire of the Holy Spirit because he burns. Thank you for that information, Pastor. I have to be at my best today. You know, this little lady back there, she intimidates me. Next Sunday, you'll hear from her. You don't know who this lady is, but I promise you, she's always in the company of prime ministers. And I won't say anymore. So I have to try and impress her, so I'm giving my best today.
Preach. Yeah.
More evidence. More evidence. Another evidence is prophesying. Where's my prophet? Transformational life. 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 says, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear. What kind of spirit has given to us? The spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of a sound mind. So when you're truly saved, I don't care your personality before. I don't care how sharp your tongue was. I don't care how you used to be with things. When you're truly saved, it's amazing the transformation. You're a different person. Some of you who are having marital problems and you stay home every day trying to argue with your spouse, you know what you need to do? Just stand into church.
Amen.
To a church that's on fire.
Amen.
Because when you're in the presence of God, there's no way you can remain the same.
Amen. Amen.
If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature or creation. All things are passed away, and behold, some things, a few things, most things, all things are become. So if you used to curse, you start to be a curser no more. If you used to steal, you become a stealer no more. If you were a murderer, you become a murderer. Into being, but you don't have a transformed life, then what's the sense of prophecy?
Yes.
So what we do is we try to pick the different evidences against each other. While Christ is saying, the church that will really be on fire is a church that will understand that all the evidences are important. And we should try and embody all of them.
Amen. Amen.
So here's what some churches say. Some churches say, well, he should have the gift of prophecy. So you don't want to prophesy. He has the gift of transformation. So he does all the transforming. What is the problem with that? We're incomplete. There are gifts of the Spirit where some of us can operate better than others. So for example, I'm a pretty good singer. When I'm in my shower, all by myself, and none of you can tell me I can't sing, because I know I can sing. But I can't sing good enough to qualify to be on the choir. Because David won't let me on the choir. So my gift is not to sing, but I can sing. You understand the difference?
Yes.
So my gift might not be in prophesying, but that doesn't mean that I don't operate in the prophetic when it's needed. So let me give you some scriptures now to tie this together, and then we'll get excited. Gentlemen, what do you want to do? You feel strong enough? You can stand? Okay, come, stand, line up again, and stay with me. Stay with me, gentlemen. You guys looking good. Let's clap our hands for these evidences. All right. Now, to balance the epic, seemingly contradicting scriptures, such as on one hand, a scripture like this, Mark 16, verse 17. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. The Bible does say that. So to balance that scripture against another scripture like 1 Corinthians 12, 28, starting from 28, that says, and God has set some in the church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that, miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governance, diversities of tongues. Verse 29, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Verse 30, have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? See that? So there's a scripture that asks, does everybody speak in tongues? And then there's a scripture that says, you will do these things in my name. You will cast out devils. You will speak in tongues. So which one is right? Which one is right? To truly understand that, we need to keep reading the text. Verse 31, 1 Corinthians 12. But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you an even more excellent way. So what you understood is just the basics. And that's what church does. It gives us the basics. But there's more. Now, in our Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 stops at verse 31. When the original script was written, there was no chapter and there was no verse. It was just one completed thought. So to get the full thought, you gotta keep reading. The next verse after 1 Corinthians 12, 31 is not 32. There's no 32. It's not the next chapter, which is 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1. So it's the same set of thought. And it says, though I speak with the tongues of men or the tongues of angels, and I have not charity, I am become as a sounding brass or as a tinkling cymbal. Verse 2, and though I have the gift of prophecy and I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove even mountains, Christ have crucified the flesh with affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. That tells me that it is possible to live in the Spirit, but not walk in the Spirit. And a lot of churches promote living in the Spirit, singing the songs where the Spirit comes from, but we do not walk in the Spirit. Notice what the Bible says in Galatians. The fruit of the Spirit is. It didn't say the fruits of the Spirit are. In other words, it is only one fruit. It's just one fruit with different slices. You cut one slice and you get mango. You cut another slice and you get orange. You cut another slice and you get banana. You cut another slice and you get
maizeberry.
Pineapple. Cut another slice and you get guava. Cut another slice and you get
pineapple.
Avocado. Is avocado fruit? Cut another slice and somewhere down here is a piece of chicken. Is that a fruit? Is egg a fruit?
No.
What is egg?
It's a protein. Salad.
What is egg? I don't even know what egg is.
A protein.
I'm going to try and bring this home now. Oh God. I'm going to try and bring this home now. There is a question to ask. Stay with me, folks. Because all of what I've done for the last 40 minutes is to build up to a particular point. And it is this. At what point along a believer's salvation journey is the Holy Spirit given? In other words, at what point do you receive the Holy Spirit? At what point? This is what has messed up a lot of organizations and churches. This is what has messed us up. Because we have tried to say that at one of these points, the Holy Spirit is given. So some say, oh, if I confess Christ, then you have the Holy Spirit. Some say, oh, if you have the boldness, then you have the Holy Spirit. Some say, oh, if I speak in tongues, I have the Holy Spirit. But if I prophesy, I definitely have the Holy Spirit. Don't miss what I'm about to say now. All of these are the evidences, the external evidences of something that has already taken place. So you have received the Holy Spirit before all of this. And these are just the external evidence. There's something that will happen to you internally when you get the Holy Spirit before the external start. I'm going to take you somewhere now, because you don't want to miss this. You don't want to miss this. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But he shall receive power after that, or when the Holy Ghost is come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Listen to this. Even when we are unaware of it, at the point that we receive the Holy Spirit, we are also infused with power, supernatural power. Sometimes we don't understand how to activate the power that we have. So yesterday I was at the mall, and I got up to my car to start the car, and the stupid car wouldn't start. And I pressed, and I pressed, and I pressed,
me Woodstock. Then I realized it was my battery. So I had to call a towing company. The guy came and he plugged up to mine. And then he says, "Try and start it." And I tried to start it. And I heard this song. And he said, "Try and start it again." And I tried, and I heard. And I tried it the third time. And after the third time, I said, "I don't think it's a battery." I said, "I think it is a starter." And this old sage, he just said to me, "Leave it alone. Let it stay like that for 5 minutes." And then after about 5 minutes, he said, "Try it again." And after I tried it the next time, boom, 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 boom. What did this guy understand? He understood some stuff about charging. If it was up to me, with my uneducated mechanical sense, I would have called for a different company to change spark plug, starter, and probably take out the whole engine and replace it. When it all it needed was just to stay there a little bit more. Boom. Boom, boom. Boom. And then when it started, the fella turned to me and said, "Do not turn on the engine for a while. Let it run." Some people, when they come to church, they get charged up. And after the service, they turn off everything. And then they wonder why by Tuesday, there's no strength to be with all the things you're going through. Oh, when we start the service, when you hear the priest and worship, what we're doing is, by the time you get to the preaching, what we're doing is, we're trying to give you some power. But when the service is over, if all that is on your mind is witness and boxes and McDonald's, then you are going to be in problem. When you leave the service, you better have some more.
Introduces Jesus to us in some of his manifold ways.
And then it shows us how to tap into the power. Let's read as we close. John chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. This is the gospel, brothers and sisters. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him. Without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. This is the gospel, folks. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. Verse 7. The same came for a witness, to be a witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to be a witness of that light. Verse 9. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Verse 10. He was in the world. The world was made by him. That's the gospel. And the world knew him not. Look at verse 11. He came unto his own, and his own received him. When the gospel is preached with power, people only have two choices. They can either reject the gospel, or they can do what verse 12 then commands us. Verse 12. But as many as receive him, look at this now. To him, to them, gave he
power
to become children of God. Into them that believe on his name. So let me unwrap this for you now. When the gospel is preached with power, you can either reject it or receive it. The moment you receive it, you have power. If you reject it, you are signing your death wish to damnation. But the moment you believe the gospel and receive the gospel, the Bible says you have power. And you can't have power unless you have the Holy Spirit. So the moment you receive the gospel, you receive the Holy Spirit. So all these churches that for years are fighting amongst each other and saying, I need supernatural fire, or I need confession, or I need jar, or I need boldness, I need tongues, I need prophesy, I need transformation. All these churches that are fighting amongst each other, as opposed to realizing we're on the same team, need to understand what we need to do is just receive Jesus. Amen. Receive Jesus. The moment you receive Jesus, before you demonstrate what evidence externally, something has already happened internally. And once you already have this thing inside of you, once you start to get teachings of the evidence, then, as you come to church, as you are in your closet or in your vehicle, every single day, you get an opportunity to now try and put into practice the different evidences. So you don't need to come to church to compete. Some people only live a transformed life at church. We're nice.
good side. But see me when I'm driving and I'm late and somebody cut me off and I lend them one of my fingers. See me when I'm fighting with my spouse and the gloves are off. See me when nobody's looking and there's money in the cookie jar. That is not mine. We're just Barney. And we're Christians. Oh, but when we become a church and start to understand the working of the Holy Spirit, we don't need to prove anything to anybody. We know when we have the Spirit in us. If we have received Him, you don't need to prove to anybody. You don't need anybody to tick you off and sign you up for church. If you know you truly have received the Lord, He's in you. The Holy Spirit is in you. Then all you have to do now is look for every opportunity to activate what was in you already. So the call, let's stand anyway. The call of Christ is found in John chapter 7, verse 37. John 7, 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water." Look at verse 39. "But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive." Those who believe should receive. Those who believe should receive. It's not good enough to believe. You need to receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. I give you one last one. Romans 8, verse 14. "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons and daughters of God. For he have not received the spirit of bondage, restriction, legalism, oppression, again to fear, but he have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." In other words, my. Verse 16, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with the Spirit itself." God's Spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we are, So your confirmation that you are the children of God is not this evidence. In fact, let me show you how grace works. We cannot even display the evidences because we are immature or we are carnal. And yet still we still have the Spirit because something inside tells us we are the children of God. And when you truly know you are a child of God, for a while you might be immature or big or carnal, but you won't stay there. Because much more than your preacher or your pastor or your appearance or somebody else, there's something inside of you that's telling you, hey, you're destined for greatness. Hey, step up. Hey, leave those slimy stuff. Step up. Come up higher. Lift yourself. Lift up your head. Walk higher. Stand taller. Straighten your back. All the crooked places I've asked for this sermon to be taped. It will be on the Facebook, hopefully by tonight. In Jesus' name, meet the people before you sleep tonight. Put it on Facebook. Because I want everybody in this building to go back and watch the sermon again and let it digest. And then I want you to forward it to some people. Because if we ever get this Holy Spirit thing right, I'm telling you, we are going to unleash upon British Columbia. We are going to take this place by storm. And churches are going to come alive. People are going to come alive. Relationships are going to come alive. Whole regions are going to come alive. It is God's time. It is not Donald Trump's time. It is not Mr. Putin's time. It is not somebody else's time. It is God's time. It's the last days. And God wants the pour out of his spirit upon all flesh. So right now, I want everybody to start to pan after the Holy Spirit. If you've never received the Holy Spirit in your life, today is a good day to do it. Just say, Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I receive. If you have already repented and received it, then oh, there's more. Maybe you have learned to speak in tongues or to prophesy, but you have not started to walk the walk of transformation or have abundant joy or boldness or some other evidence of the Holy Spirit. Today is the day to say, I want to go higher. I want to go higher. I want to go higher. Music people, will you help us? Worship everybody, worship everybody, worship.
You need.
going to ask everybody to give me at least 5 more minutes to first really tap into worship. Because I know I preached a little longer, and that's why we didn't have a lot of prelim, because I needed to get this message out in its entirety. I want us to really tap into worship, but before we do, I want to make a statement. There is not one evidence that the Holy Spirit has given us that is not important. There is not one evidence that we won't need at some point. Nobody in the building should leave here thinking that pastor is saying, you don't need to do this. If that's how you have understood this sermon, you have missed everything I'm trying to say. In a relationship, nobody needs to do anything. Nobody needs to make coffee for your spouse. Nobody needs to do the laundry and send a text, I love you. Nobody needs to. You can do some things for survival if you want. Or you can understand that it's an honor to do some stuff. If you want, you can play the chauvinistic thing to say, well, that's not my job because I'm the man. So I can't do the dishes. I can't do the laundry. But if you keep being the man, you may not get some other stuff that you'd like to get. Some of us men really understand women. We would wash every dish with dirty dishes just to wash them. Nobody should leave here saying, I don't need to speak in tongues because pastor says, I don't need to speak in tongues. If that's how you understand this message, you have missed it. My point is, we need to do all of them.
Amen.
We should put one up and one down. We shouldn't grade any and say, this one is more potent than the other. We need to understand it's not the evidences that determine if we have the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit before the evidence even are manifested. That's the point. Once you have the Holy Spirit in you, every form of evidence we should try and promote. Now there are some people who may never speak in tongues in church. Hear me. There are some people who may never speak in tongues in church. And sometimes we want people to come to these altars so that we can hear, and we put our ears beside them to hear they're speaking in tongues. What if they don't speak in tongues here, but they speak in tongues in their car or in their closet? You see Keon? Marcella, sister, I'm afraid to be in the same room with that lady. She inspires me. I have such a respect for her. This lady diagnosed with cancer 2 weeks ago. And if you see her spirit, if you hear the prayer she prays for her family, you're almost scared to be in her presence. She said to me, Pastor, I'm not the one who comes to the front and pray. She said, Pastor, I hardly ever come to the front. But she said, Pastor, you don't know, but when I'm up top in my little way, when I'm alone with God, Pastor, I'm telling you, I'm having a time. And you know how I know the proof that what she's saying is true? Because when she is in the bed of affliction, she does not look like she's in despair. She still has the joy of the Lord. Some of us have come to the front. And we have done the evidences that people want us to do, so that we can say we have the Holy Spirit. But as soon as we hit an iceberg, everything goes through the door. You know why I like my favorite movie that begins with T? Because even when they're going under in that frigid water, Jack turned to her and said, never let go. Remember? And she looked at him and she said, never let go. And wow. Even when they're about to die, never let go. That's how you know it's real. That even adversity, nothing can shake it. I'm not telling you not to go after these things. These things are important.
But first, get it inside you and get the confirmation that your spirit speaks to God's spirit. And there's a communion, there's a confirmation. You hear Christ saying, you are now my child. You are now my child. Lift the condemnation. Lift the depression. Lift the discouragement. For if any man be in Christ, he is a new